colors of water. What does that mean?
I know that we've all seen different colors of water. Our own Salt River is a lovely color of, if you've ever seen it, the color of our pews probably, a little kind of mucky brown, not a lovely color. We've seen photographs of the ocean, especially the overhead photographs that show the colors of shifting greens and blues, so beautiful depending on how deep the water is. But water has so many different colors and uses. Living in the desert, we all know how important water is. Probably most of us don't think about it that much because we kind of take it for granted. As for me, when I'm at home, I just turn a spigot or a faucet and I get the water that I'm looking for. Sometimes I get a little irritated because it takes so long for it to turn hot so I can wash my dishes. Inconvenience, right? We can even get picky about water, filtered water. My mother has a soft water system in her house, and so I have to remember, okay, the soap is probably already off. It just feels slimy, right? Hot water for this, cold water for that. I even have a favorite brand of bottled water. In the desert here, even some of us have great big holes in our backyard for recreation. But water is so much more than the little bit of attention we give to it. I remember the month, just a few short weeks after I became your pastor here, September of 2014, we had a lot of water here at the church. And it can be destructive. Every room in this whole facility was flooded except for the sanctuary and the kitchen and the youth room. That's a lot of water, a lot of destruction. So I have seen pictures in New Orleans, Louisiana after Hurricane Katrina. I've seen pictures of the water damage from tsunamis, from tornadoes. I know that includes wind, but water, frozen water can even break trees and power lines or roofs in other climates. It's hard for us to imagine that here in the desert. I have to admit that the last 2 years here, I have felt as if I was in the eye of a hurricane. Chaos and destruction all around us. And I take a deep breath in a small space of safety and calm and wait for the next passage of the storm. That word storm symbolizes more than just wind and water, doesn't it? When we hear it or think of it, it's almost always in the context of destructive forces. It conjures up something that is dangerous and dark and fearsome. When we are reading our Holy Scripture and we see the word water, we need to stop. In God's Word, water means more than just a drink or foot washing. In the ancient world, water symbolizes chaos as well as giving life. Our scripture readings today all talk about water, the water that God has created and continues to create and to use. Water that is so common in our lives, we can take it for granted. And water that is useful and water that destroys. But water that is also evidence of holiness, of God working in us and through us and for others. We will read about the dangerous water that threatens and the sacramental water that cleanses and restores. The passage that we're going to read from Isaiah is one of my favorites. It is so beautiful to read because it is lyrical. It sounds like poetry. But the promises are so powerful. God's people have been exiled. They've been taken away from their homes and everything that they loved and that was familiar and safe for them. These people were broken and grieving, and then God sent this word to them through his prophet Isaiah. We're going to be reading from the prophet Isaiah chapter 43, verses 1 through 7. Israel's only savior. But now, this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I gave Egypt for your ransom, Cush and Seba in your stead. Since you are precious and honored in my sight, and because I love you, I will give people in exchange for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bring your children from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. This is the word of God for the people of God. And all God's people said, thanks be to God. You may be seated. When? In verse 1, we read that Jacob was created, but Israel was formed. And if we've read our scripture, we know that those two are the same person. God transforms Jacob into Israel. God is a creative God. God changes our nature. And then in verse 2, we read that word, when. When we pass through the deep stormy sea. When we pass through raging rivers. This promise is so necessary, isn't it? We need to know that God will always be with us when the storms come. When we are overwhelmed. When we cannot manage on our own. God's presence as we go through difficulties becomes our deliverance. God's presence. One of our favorite psalms repeats this for us, doesn't it? Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. When? And when this catastrophe strikes us, it's frequently catastrophic, isn't it? We are blindsided by a calamity. Blindsided, that means you don't see it coming. However, this when can also be unnoticeable, not a catastrophe. Bit by bit, little by little, erosion. We have to be holding on to God's hand all the time so we are not overtaken by the daily, by the little by little slipping away from that healthy space next to God. The erosion of that relationship. And in verse 7 that we just read, we see the bottom line for us. We were created, we were formed for a reason. To reflect God's glory. Our whole purpose in life is to love God, to experience God's goodness, and to reflect that back to God, and as a result, to everyone around us. I have shared with you before a little story, and I'm going to share with you again right now about my grandfather, John McCracken, John Edmund McCracken, a wonderful man. He was my idol, a lifelong believer, and a member of the Evangelical Friends tribe. Both of my grandfathers were pastors in this tradition, a tribe that did not practice the sacraments in the same manner that we do. Let me explain. The Nazarene tribe celebrates two sacraments, baptism and the sacred meal. We believe that God works in us and through these two ordinary events of bathing and eating to work God's mysteries of love and grace. The Evangelical Friends, which are a branch of the Quaker tribe, believe that everything we do is a sacrament. That's the short version. And so they do not practice these two sacraments in the same way that we do. When John McCracken, my grandfather, was in his 80s and living with my mother, he decided that he was going to be baptized. Now, a lifelong Quaker pastor, and now at the end of his life and the end of his ministry, he wanted to be baptized. He took great joy in explaining why. pointing to Scripture and saying, here, that's why, if Jesus was baptized, I want to be baptized also. And so he was. Now we're going to read a longer version of the passage that Pastor Andy read this morning early, a little bit earlier. I'll be reading from the Passion Translation. Luke chapter 3, verses 15 to 22. During those days, everyone was gripped with messianic expectations, believing the Messiah could come at any moment, and many began to wonder if John might be the Christ. But John made it clear by telling them, "There's one coming who is mightier than I. He is supreme. In fact, I'm not worthy of even being his slave. I can only baptize you in this river, but he will baptize you into the spirit of holiness and into his raging fire. He has in his hands a winnowing fork to clean up his threshing floor. He will separate the wheat from the chaff. The wheat he will gather into his barn, but he will burn the chaff in a fire that no one can ever put out." One day, Jesus came to be baptized along with all the others. As he was consumed with the spirit of prayer, the heavenly realm ripped open above him, and the Holy Spirit descended from heaven in the form of a dove and landed on him. Then God's audible voice was heard saying, "My son, you are my beloved one. Through you I am fulfilled." This is the word of God for the people of God. And all God's people said, thanks be to God. You may be seated. Water. The fearsome, dangerous water of the storm in which God promises to journey with us is now the muddy River Jordan, where John the Baptist is washing the faithful. How can this common, unclean water bring the kingdom of God? God inhabits the mysteries that surround us. It is just like God to use something so easy for us to overlook and make something beautiful out of it. Jesus enters the water along with all the others, even though he is God, and fulfills the design and becomes beloved. Jesus identifies with sinners, identifies with us, even at his baptism. Although Jesus had no sin, he chooses to do the same thing that the sinners need to do, chooses to become one with the sinners, and is washed by John as a preview of what will happen when he becomes sin and is judged for our sins at the cross. There is this wonderful opportunity we have as Christ followers to be a people resting in God's love. When overwhelmed, rejected, not meeting the expectations of others, can we breathe deep of our belovedness and respond in ways that are engaged while also non-anxious? Can we ask questions at the moment that might mean making changes in our schedules? Can we reflect on the hurt that causes others to reject, to review our expectations internally and what we expect of others? Since we are beloved, we are free to speak honestly of where we have failed and when we need to confess. There's an invitation to freedom in our vocation, what we do and say, and in our relationships, when the goal isn't some success rubric where we might be judged or graded, but instead we can live a life of love with truth, beauty, grace, because we are so deeply loved. The delight of God is a song sung over us as we are simply being faithful to God's call and love. But we don't have to be successful. We don't have to impress. We don't have to be anything but faithful to the call of Christ in this moment and today, dwelling in the knowledge of God's love. just like Pastor Andy told us a few minutes ago. And this morning, I really needed to hear this myself. It's so easy to judge ourselves by our failures, by what we see as what is lacking in our lives, isn't it? But God loves us if we are faithful, if we're even just trying to be faithful. We have experienced two very different scripture readings this morning that both deal with the ordinary, everyday substance of water, something we cannot do without. In Isaiah, we recognize that water is dangerous and frightening, but that God promises to be in it with us, no matter what is happening. And in Dr. Luke's passage about baptism, the baptism of King Jesus, we are humbled to see God submitting to an ordinary washing that so gloriously demonstrates the grace and beauty of the gospel message. That by submitting ourselves to something so ordinary, so necessary, when we recognize God in it, God meets us there. If you are in the sanctuary with me right now, I would say, can I hear an amen? The colors of water. As I was contemplating the mystery of water this week, I began to think of a common household chore, one that I do every week, one that I performed approximately 20 to 25 times a week when my kiddos were younger, and you might be able to guess, laundry. Evidence of holiness. When I do laundry, what's happening? I take clothes that have been soiled by my own wearing, seeing the stains of my activity or the mistakes I've made. I could throw them away, putting them out of my sight, but what I do instead is I submit them to water and soap and agitation and time, and then new clothing, my clothing is useful again. I put it on and I go about my life, wearing it all over again, submitting it to the possibility of becoming dirty, the probability of becoming dirty again. So my prayer this morning is about laundry. The simple chore of washing laundry becomes holy when I recognize God in it. As I draw the freshly laundered clothes from the dryer, may the sight and scent of new cleanness remind me of the righteousness that is now mine. May it remind me of the ongoing forgiveness that God extravagantly offers to us. The new life that God eternally and forever has created for us who recognize and admit that we are soiled and in need of cleansing. May the aroma of my clean clothes be a continual reminder throughout the day of my new life in Christ, and a desire to share that aroma day to day and week to week, becoming more like Christ as I walk and I work and I launder. Amen. For the sending this week, every time you take a drink or turn on the faucet, stop and thank God for the mercy and grace of your salvation, of the cleansing that God has offered to you. And now for the benediction. May the God who turned the water into wine to celebrate a human event show you the wonder that is in front of you. Amen.
How about this? My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ and righteousness, my solid rock. How about the church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. A mighty fortress is my God, a bulwark never failing.